Our next speaker is Lindsey German, who was indeed one of the founders of the Stop War Coalition. She is the convener of the coalition to this day. She's been absolutely central to organising the movement over the last 10 years. Please give Lindsey a big round of applause.
Not just thank everybody for coming, because I think this is an incredibly important issue, but also to thank Abbas for his outline of the issues in some detail about what is happening in Iran. Because it seems to me that we are in a very, very dangerous situation now in the world, not just over the question of Iran. If you look more widely, I want to start slightly more widely. I think of all the 10 years of the war on terror, in many ways we are now in some of the most critical times. And we're in some of the most critical times because the war in Afghanistan has failed, the war in Iraq has failed, and the American troops are coming out this year. There is no acknowledgement about the failure. Worse than that, this year the Western powers have now intervened in Libya in the name of humanitarian intervention, but have killed thousands of civilians as a result of their intervention. They're trying to intervene covertly in Syria and using Turkey and other powers in order to do so. And they are also escalating the tension in relation to Iran. The fact that now there are lots of sanctions being imposed, the fact that effectively the attack on the British embassy has resulted in effectively breaking diplomatic links between Britain and Iran, and the fact that the British are encouraging the other EU powers to, at least in a token way, do the same kind of thing, tells you exactly what a dangerous game the so-called international community is playing. And they're doing so because of their failure, not because of their success. We are living in a time of severe economic crisis, where there is a recession, they say in Britain, a double-dip recession, a huge crisis over the euro, or across the whole of Europe, all the tensions that are now coming out between the different European powers, which were supposed to be so united. In this situation, the likelihood of war doesn't become less likely, it becomes more likely. And lots of the solutions, if you look historically at when wars have happened, they have been when the governments have not been able to solve their political and economic problems, and that therefore they turn to war as what seems like an easy solution to the crisis. And I must say, when I look at what is happening today with the banging of the drum over war with Iran, with the situation in the Middle East, I think we are in a very dangerous situation. I feel very, very strongly, and I'm sure everybody on this panel feels very, very strongly, that a war with Iran, even a supposedly proxy war with Israel playing the lead role, but backed up very much, as we know, by the United States, by the EU, by all the Western powers, will be a war which is not just with Iran. It will be a war which is for the whole of the Middle East and, of course, the whole of South Asia, and it's probably going to spread even wider than that. This is how high the stakes are, in my opinion. I think they are extremely high stakes, and when these desperate rulers who brought us these wars see their failures building up, it doesn't make them think twice. It makes them think, we'll do this because we don't really have any alternative. And this is the truly frightening situation that we are in. That 10 years after imperialism launched this war on terror, they are mired deeper and deeper into the crisis with it. They have borrowed money to pay for these wars. was. This is what the deficit is all about. The public sector workers. Who marched around this country last week and who struck in defence of their pensions in one of the richest countries in the world, they're being told we can't afford pensions, are the people who are now having to pay for the drones, for the bombing, for the invasions that have gone on over the last 10 years. And this government is addicted to war, and they claim that they do not have the money to pay for essentials, but they will always find money to pay for wars. And therefore there's a big choice, I think, facing not just people in Britain, but people around the world. What kind of world do we want? Do we want a world which is driven more and more to war, or do we want a world based on justice and equality? And the question of Iran is going to pose this in a very, very sharp way. It's already posing it in a sharp way, because as Abbas has pointed out, this war has already begun in its covert form and in its sanctions form. And let's remember what Iraq was about. Iraq was exactly about years and years and years, going right back to the war in 1990, 1991. It was about years and years and years of imposing sanctions, and some people thought sanctions maybe were okay in those days. Weren't they a better alternative? Because at least it didn't mean killing, it didn't mean bombing, it didn't mean war. We now know everything about the Iraqi experience has to tell us that those sanctions weren't an alternative to war, they were a prelude to war. And this is what we're going to be seeing. And it's for this reason that I feel very, very strongly we have to oppose any attack on Iran. Now, we all know, well, I'm sure all of us in this room know, that this is an issue where the Western powers do their utmost to try to provide humanitarian reasons for opposing the Iranian regime. They talk about human rights. They talk about human rights all over the Middle East. Well, not quite all over the Middle East, because in Saudi Arabia, it's okay not to have human rights. In a whole number of other places, in Bahrain, it's okay not to have human rights. In Israel and Palestine, of course, it's okay not to even be able to live in the country that your ancestors were born in. All of those things are okay. But they're very concerned about human rights in some countries. Those countries include what George Bush said nearly 10 years ago with the axis of evil, if you remember, which included Syria and Iran. This has been demonized for this long. They care about human rights there, and we should be absolutely clear that any war on Iran, firstly, is not about human rights. We may have disagreements with the Iranian government, with many governments, as I do, over the question of human rights. It's something that I will fight against repression of people's civil liberties in any country that I am capable of making any opposition to the repression of civil liberties. But do not believe for a moment that human rights is what these governments are all about. Do not believe for a moment that this is what the British government, which has its own neocons like Michael Gove in it, or the American government, and all the neocons who are there in the right-wing Republicans who are standing for election over the next year, do not believe for a moment they care about the rights of trade unions, the rights of women, the rights of demonstrators or anybody else, because they are doing their best. If you look at America, the Occupy movement has been repressed and attacked in every city in the United States, and this is exactly what they do to anybody who stands up and opposes their government. So let's hear a little bit less. Another thing it's not about is nuclear weapons. I'm against nuclear weapons. I'm against nuclear power. But let's not kid ourselves that Iran is the biggest nuclear threat, not just now, but potentially the biggest nuclear threat. The only country in the Middle East that has nuclear weapons, as a matter of fact, is Israel. This isn't owned up to, but everybody knows it's true. In fact, I saw the other day the Israelis said, we'll give up our nuclear weapons if the Iranians do. Well, they've got nuclear weapons, the Iranians don't have nuclear weapons. It's a rather peculiar way of looking at it. But the truth is, Iran is surrounded by countries that have nuclear weapons. This isn't a good thing, but actually it is a fact that India and Pakistan and Israel, all sorts of countries, plus all the nuclear weapons that are on the American fleets that are stationed in the region. The hypocrisy to say that this is about we don't want nuclear weapons in any one country. The British government, which has had nuclear weapons for decades and which helped the Israelis to get their nuclear weapons. The Americans, which are the only country that have ever used nuclear weapons, as they did in 1945 in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. What are we talking about when we talk about this as a pretext for war, which will then involve nuclear weapons? It is absolutely insane. Now, as Abbas also said, people say they couldn't be mad enough to do this. I'm afraid that I think it isn't about madness, it's about a drive for war, which has gripped the rulers of the world, and we have to be the people who oppose it. In 2003, when we got 2 million people on the streets in London and something like 30 million people marched across the globe against the war in Iraq, we didn't succeed in stopping the war, and that is to our eternal regret, our eternal sadness that we weren't able to do that. But what we did do was to build a mass anti-war opinion around the world, which is still there. Even when they bombed Libya in the name of helping the citizens of Benghazi, there were still 37% of people right from the beginning who opposed any bombing there and who opposed any war. Country will not want a war with Iran, but then you get the Sun, you get the BBC, which in my view is sometimes a lot worse than the Sun, with its kind of, you know, the Jeremy Clarkson values obviously spread between the two of them. That you have the constant drip, drip, drip of what can only be called propaganda. That is exactly what it is when you get the soldiers telling us how the war in Afghanistan is a big success, how the people in Afghanistan, we had it again this morning on the radio, how the people in Afghanistan, what would they do if British troops weren't there to help them? It's constantly what you get all the time, and we will get all this. That is why we have to build a movement against the wars in Afghanistan that are continuing, any attack on Syria or anywhere else, but in my view, the threat to Iran is the one which is taking on a form, not just of threats, but the fact that you have these the sanctions, the fact that you have this, you can see this move towards it. This is a very, very big threat that we have to fight against, and therefore the movement has to mobilise. We have to do it at every level. We have to get our communities, our friends. We have to get the trade union movement, which passed a very good resolution on Afghanistan at the TUC conference in September. We have to go back around this question of Iran. We have to get the students, we have to get everybody back on the streets, holding meetings, back organising and petitioning and direct action and everything else that we can think of doing, because we have to make it clear, we're a minority at the moment, but we have to make it clear to millions and millions of people in this country that they are raising the stakes of war, and this war, this time, will be a war which is far more serious than anything else we've seen in the last 10 years. And if they are worried about their economic crisis, they will still continue to take us to war. That is a really frightening question. And that is why our movement, which has been so powerful in the past, has to keep organising, has to keep mobilising until we defeat this attack.
Thanks very much, Lindsey.